There is hate and dissension right now, fear and fumbling. What will the future be for the Jewish people? Pew report and police reports that make many of our people feel as unsafe as they ever have. Tonight, I'm not talking about the oldest hate, which is choking our people from the outside, which Senator Linda Frum eloquently described as a deep cultural malformation that starts with ancient paranoid fantasies and culminates in violence in the streets of Montreal. This is worrying, this is terrifying, and this anxiety is only confounded by an even larger challenge that is causing dissension in our homes. Our rabbis teach that Moses found his most powerful challenges were not Pharaoh or the horsemen of Egypt, but the divisions within the Jewish people. This week, I've seen the stress of isolation and a war in Israel create hatred and splits within Jewish homes, between parents and children, between siblings. Some see these conversations happening around them and see them as a split in liberal Judaism, a return to a Judaism unburdened by peoplehood, a reformed Judaism unburdened by responsibility to the dispersed Jewish people, a reformed Judaism concerned more with the suffering of others than the suffering of our people, our cousins abroad. But friends, that version of reformed Judaism never existed. The specter of a reformed Judaism so concerned with others that we neglect our brothers and sisters abroad is a straw man built to be burned in a fiery elocution as a warning to those who would dare to use the word Palestinian in polite Jewish discourse, who would engage with treason to suggest that a Jewish heart can be a place with many rooms, holding many complex truths all at once, who say, these people must be traitors to Israel, anti-Zionists, and must be kept out of our communal Israel discourse, violently and at all costs. For my 8 years here at Holy Blossom Temple, I have strived to keep our community's tikkun olam work separate from our conversations about Israel. When we have studied social justice, I have always said, don't use the word Israel or Palestine in your conversation, or no one will be able to engage in the Canadian conversation productively. Holy Blossom Temple has a Department of Israel and Tikkun Olam, and over these past 8 years, I've tried my best to stop the two from mixing, because I have felt it would only find blocked ears and hardened hearts. But maybe these past few weeks, maybe we have a shift. It certainly has shifted for a few members of our congregation that have reached out to me to discuss the generational splits in their families. The older generation remembering the miracles of Zionism, and the younger generation experiencing anti-Semitism on social media and being expected to defend the actions of the current Israeli government, yet are not willing to do so in the ways their parents expect. Not willing to hear or stand up for one side of any discourse. Rabbi Josh Weinberg, the head of Artsa in the United States, wrote last week about Maimonides' Guide for the Perplexed. People like the opinions to which they have been accustomed from their youth, writes Maimonides. They defend them and shun contrary views. And this is one of the things that prevents people from finding the truth, for they cling to the opinions of habit. It is hard to open our hearts to many truths. This past weekend, I co-chaired the World Union of Progressive Judaism's conference. Much was pre-recorded and was difficult to shift into the moment emerging around us, but we were able to shift a few things. When discussing the conflict, we centered Israeli and Palestinian voices as much as we could, raising up the voices of peacemakers and those within the reform movement in Israel working for shared society. In planning a program with the Reform Movement's Leobek Education Center in Haifa, I asked them about putting a program together about coexistence work. Benji Maor reprimanded me by email. At Leobek, we don't do coexistence work. We build a shared society. This is the way of Haifa. And we heard from an Arab and a Jewish high school student there at our Reform Educational Institution about how outsiders came into their city, marked the apartment buildings where Arabs lived, and how awkward that was to them because they knew that those buildings were split almost exactly 50-50 between Arab and Jewish inhabitants. And they told of how they fought for a Haifa of unity. Our teens this past Sunday heard from students their age in Israel about how complicated they feel the situation is and how they want the world to know how much their hearts weep for every child killed and how they fear for their own safety and security, a story they feel isn't told enough. And yet, even as our own youth talk about the many places in their own hearts, the many spaces that they can hold at once, their voices are discounted as we circle the wagons, as we define Jewish community as divorced from the voice from Sinai. But only we can be a people of Israel who we forget as we marched, yearned for that voice from the mountain. Our rabbi here at Holy Blossom in the 20s and 30s, Maurice Eisendrath, taught, "The agonizing cry of our fathers for freedom is fast fading into silence as today so many of our number yearn only to come home, to crowd in upon ourselves, to remember little, except that we are Jews. Universalism is superficially confused with 19th century cosmopolitanism and assimilationism, while particularism or nationalism, whether it be of the Palestinian," he means in the modern day Israeli, "or the diaspora brand, this is alone countenance as worthy of our Jewish loyalty. And thus we of this generation are failing once again to catch that subtle and precious secret of Israel's uniqueness, of Israel's age-old persistence, that secret which is to be found solely in the harmony, the blending, the synthesis of the particular and the universal." Our Torah portion this week begins with menorah, a light which shines out into the world. This is a light which requires the Jewish people to be its ever constant keepers, to keep it burning in times of darkness, to keep the embers alive even in the most troubled of nights. It spreads to the world, yet it originates with us. Sometimes that light makes us shudder at what we see of ourselves, but it is still ours to keep burning. Sometimes the shadows it casts scare us into seeing things that are not there, and yet we, the Jewish people, must still try to use it as a guide the best we can. It is a light which preserves all of our Jewish selves, a people and an exemplar, a nation tied by tradition and destiny, and a people called to a sacred purpose of helping all escape from narrow places. Within this mission, there is not a dichotomy, a tear. There is one Judaism as there is one God. Some people say to their students as they head to university, "You are entering a war zone." This is true. But it is not the war others tell you that you are entering. It is a war inside of the self. How will you take this flame and keep it alive, even when you doubt and stumble? Even when the winds of opinion shift around you? How will you ask the questions needed to keep that flame healthy and strong? I pray that you will always have the strength to carry it, and that it may forever be a light to the many rooms of your hearts, granting you a mission and granting us all, Jews and non-Jews, a greater sense of wholeness and peace. I'll end with the prayer Rabbi Tati Shagas, a member of the Israeli Reform Rabbinic Council, prayed last Saturday at the World Union Conference. Od Navi Shalom Aleinu V'al Kulam. May we be the bringers of peace for ourselves and for the world. Shabbat Shalom.